You're watching Public Affairs. Berkowitz is my name, and politics is our game, and we will be doing lots of politics and public policy this evening. Perhaps more public policy, because we have an unusual guest for our annual Christmas show. We're taping this on December 19th, and we're wishing everybody perhaps a belated Merry Christmas, a Happy New Year coming up. And, you know, the thing is, everybody's talking about the economy. You know, it's the economy, stupid. We heard that saying with Bill Clinton. We hear it. So people are wondering, wouldn't it be nice, Jeff, to get, rather than your usual hack politician, of which we've had about 700, including our current president. I don't want to call him a hack, but some people would call him, because he's a politician. Everybody knows that. So instead of getting hack politicians, I'm including everybody, Democrats, Republicans, old, new, fat, you know, fat and thin, the rich and the poor, your typical, you know, politically correct statement. Everybody's included in that. They're all hacks. Instead of having those folks out here, bring on an economist, Jeff. Bring on somebody from the University of Chicago. You're always touting that place. Who knows all the answers. Who knows why unemployment is still over 9%. Who knows why GDP has not returned to the same path it was. We're almost to the same level at the time of the crash, which is a little perplexing because, you know, the stock market is double what it once was not too long ago. But you don't want to hear that from me. You want to hear it from Professor John Cochran, because he's the guy with all the answers. He's a professor at the University of Chicago. It's the University of Chicago Booth School of Finance. And John, what's the full name? Distinguished Professor of what? It's such a long title, I can't fit it on the screen.
Yes, I have a long title.
Now, what is that?
The important part is that I am
a
professor.
No, give me an answer. You're going to have to give answers.
Okay, I am the...
Let's start with it. Softball.
Okay.
What's your title?
AQR, Capital Management Distinguished Service Professor of Finance at the University of Chicago's Booth School of Business.
Okay.
That is my formal title.
And second most important to that is there's this book coming out. And we're putting I'm confusing my crew because we're going to start with capitalism and freedom. Well, maybe we'll start with that. Capitalism and Freedom is sort of the basic book we're talking about here. That, of course, was written by Milton Friedman.
Yes.
Something you read how long ago? How many years ago?
So many times it fades into memory.
You've read it numerous times.
Yes.
And each time you find additional nuggets of wisdom in there.
It's a good book.
And you recommend people rush out. If you're watching the show and you want a book, we don't usually give plugs, but if you want something to give wisdom to your kids, wisdom to your grandchildren. Theo, are you listening? Wisdom to your kids, as we said. Karen, Lauren, are you listening? Wisdom all around to everybody you know. You say what? You get Capitalism and Freedom by Milton Friedman. You send out like 100 of those. And next year, you'll have 100 very smart, knowledgeable people, right? Because they've read Capitalism and Freedom.
Well, there's lots of good books.
And I'm good. You see, this guy is my straight guy. It's good you mentioned that.
I will be your straight guy.
Because second on our list for 2012, the hit book of 2012, and here's a prediction I make this prediction, Monstrous Beauty. It's a sleeper, so to speak. What do we have, a mermaid on the cover?
We have a mermaid on the cover, a young adult novel of
Can
romance
we get a good shot?
And mermaids and mysteries and anything you could want.
Okay.
Coming
and that,
out next year by Elizabeth Fama, coincidentally my wife.
Your wife, okay. And you're not, you have no conflict of interest in saying, looking at all the books you've read, how many have you read, like 300, 500, 1,000?
Hundreds
and hundreds. Of all the books, seriously, John Cochran had to wait just a few minutes as we were getting ready for the show, and I noticed he was engrossed and buried in a book, and I thought, oh, it's something on economics of finance or something like that, or Adam Smith, Wealth of Nations, or Capitalism and Freedom, or Monetary History of the United States. And what was it?
Monstrous Beauty.
And you were only halfway through it because this is an advanced copy, right?
Yes, coming out this summer.
It's a what, a romance novel?
It's a young adult fiction, including romance and mermaids and mysteries and all sorts of great things.
Will be the hit book of summer of 2012, but the important thing, John, okay, enough kidding around. People really want to know this answer, John. Why is unemployment still over 9% when the stimulus program, which was $800 billion, and Barack Obama and your good colleague, Austin Goolsbee, who was chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors at some point, maybe not at that time, is now returned to the faculty at the University of Chicago. Your good friend and colleague, Austin Goolsbee, didn't he, along with the chairman of the council, whose name escapes me, what's that broad's name?
Christina Romer, and
yeah,
we call her a woman.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Just kidding. My daughters would remind me that. That young lady's name, Christina Romer. She's the chairman of the Council
That's
of Economic
right,
Advisors.
Austin.
And she promised, she said, if you folks go out and pass this stimulus of Barack Obama, $800 billion, right? Unemployment won't go over 8%. Isn't that what she said?
That was her unfortunate forecast.
So yes. Not only did unemployment go up and over 8%, it went over 9%, went up to 10%, it's still over 9%, almost 3 years into the Obama administration. Is that any way to run a railroad, John Cochran?
Well, it would be nice if it were lower, but I hate to disappoint you. The answer in economics is that there aren't easy answers. You don't just find some sage and say, oh, here's the three-second answer, and then have a big federal policy and spend trillions of dollars and it all goes away.
You mean, well, yes or no? Was it the right policy? If you had been there, would you have recommended to the President, Barack Obama, that he have a so-called stimulus program of $800 billion to resurrect an economy that has admittedly in the doldrums?
Absolutely not. And in my analysis of stimulus and reading the academic literature on it, I don't think it works. I don't think anybody has real reasons why it would work, and I think it was a big waste of time and a lot of waste of money relative to things that might have helped a lot.
Is there a stimulus of a different design, larger, smaller, more infrastructure, whatever? Is there a stimulus of a different design that you think you might have recommended to bring this economy back?
Well, let's distinguish the two things that ought to happen in a recession. In a recession, when you have bad economic times, there's no question that the government should keep spending and borrow money if necessary to do it. Just as you and your household, if you're temporarily unemployed, it makes sense to keep your spending level reasonable. And then to borrow a little bit and then pay it off when you get that new great job or at NBC News or whatever's coming your way.
So if at the time, as I recall, going back to the summer of 2008, the big crash occurred, what, in the fall of 2008?
Fall of 2008. So regular, the cyclical
credit
kind of
froze up, right? Isn't that what they said?
Yeah.
Does that have any meaning to you in economics? Credit froze up?
Yes. No, we
so somebody
had,
took the credit and they put it in the freezer?
No.
And they couldn't find it?
We had a run. A run, yes.
Not like a good run. A run on the banks?
We had a run
on the financial institutions?
We had a run on the shadow banking system.
Lehman Brothers, was that it?
Following Lehman Brothers, surrounding Lehman Brothers.
Bear Stearns, was that it?
Bear Stearns was a little bit before the big crisis. The big crisis was fall 2008.
Okay.
Fannie and Freddie, AIG, Bear Stearns, Lehman Brothers, the whole business.
That was the mess.
Central,
what happened?
The central phenomenon of that
firms?
Mess, remember Mary Poppins when little Michael can't get his money and everyone wants their money out at the same time? That's basically what happened to our financial system in the fall of 2008.
People wanted their money. It was like a run on the banks. These aren't banks or traditional banks, but we used to have many so-called runs on banks. If you look back in the economic history of the United States, right, at least for 200 years, we would have runs on banks off and on. Maybe not for 200 years, from about 1776, when this country started sort of its independence.
Yes.
To about,
1933,
we had many runs on banks.
Right.
What happened in 1933 to stop runs on banks?
Nothing. We had big runs on banks.
After 1933?
We had a big, yes, the central part of the...
When was the last run on banks we had before this last one?
After there have been many runs started, but that didn't stop.
No, we didn't have so many. When did FDIC come into being?
Okay, I know where you're going now. Yes, in the 1930s...
I learned a few things. I didn't go to the University of Chicago Economics just to eat my lunch, right? Where am I going with this?
Well, you have good lunches, too.
They do. Do they still have Hutch Commons there?
Is that right? Hutch Commons is still in operation now with an attractive food court.
Okay.
Yes. Now, we had a run on the shadow banking system, the broker-dealer network, not on the regular banks, because those, as you mentioned, are protected by deposit insurance.
When did that happen? The FDIC?
The FDIC was late 1930s when it was...
Now, Milton Friedman said, when he was alive, we say this with all respect, Milton Friedman was the premier economist of the 20th century, right?
Yes.
Okay. He said, you know, after the FDIC, you don't have to worry about runs on banks anymore, right? Didn't he say that?
He may have said that. Now we get to see if he's right or not.
But it was, you certainly have to run, you don't have to worry because people are insured, so to speak, assured and insured, up to $200,000, now it's $250,000. If you spread your money around, you can have it all insured. There's no reason to run to get it out. Milton might not have favored FDIC insurance to begin with, but when he saw it, which when is it happened, why, he would say it's a positive thing.
Which is why we did not have a run on the banks. We had a run on the shadow banking system, which was not FDIC insured. And now we're about to test the limits of that because Europe is having a run on its banks because there simply is not enough money in the world to bail
everybody
out.
The real banks, commercial banks. Because they don't have FDIC insurance.
They have insurance. They have
government. People don't believe that they don't have faith in that insurance.
That's right, because the amount of the insurance is more than the governments have the resources to bail everybody out.
Okay, so back to the U.S. What happened? We had these runs on these non-commercial banks, these investment banks, sort of.
Right.
People want to take their money out because they're afraid they're going to go under. And as people start taking money out, what happened?
Financial system basically froze up. Yes, okay. So that's where we started.
Meaning
with this.
People just said no more loans. We just, until things get sorted out, we don't want to lend out money because we're not sure about the assets we have. Because along at the same time, people were discovering this Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac problem, right?
Right. So
this mortgage problem. There are a lot of bad mortgages out there that are wrapped up into securities. People own securities that they thought were safe, and they had been rated as good, not junk bonds, right? But good bonds. Turns out those ratings were wrong, right?
Yes, and more deeply, all of those things were held in fragile structures. Mortgage-backed securities are great because, like stocks, if you lose money in the stock market, all you can do is go home, have a whiskey, kick the dog, and your wife says, honey, too bad. These were all held in ways that people thought there wasn't any risk, and they could all try to run out in front of the door, and then the whole house of cards falls down.
So there was a lot of risk where people didn't think there was risk. So that was one cause, would we say, of the economic crash, that there were a lot of risky assets out there that people didn't know were risky, and when they started suspecting they were more risky, they just froze up. They just thought, no more action. Is that what happened when we have freeze? I mean, we're going to sort things out, so we're going to just sort of freeze. In a sense, we'd freeze the economy in place until people sorted out and said, should I make more loans? Should I make fewer? Should I invest?
Short version, yes, and I'm glad you brought up the historical precedent, the many hundreds of years of bank panics, because we did have this many times. There would be a run, there'd be a short panic, a quick recession, and then we would bounce back. And to bring things back to where you started, some of the puzzle right now is why we are not bouncing back as quickly as we did before.
And we're not bouncing back because we're almost 3 years into this, and if you graph it, you can see that we're not quite to where we were in gross domestic product. Our level of gross domestic product is not quite yet to the level it was in 2008 when the crash began, right?
That's exactly. We've just about caught up to where we were, which in one sense is a good thing. That means that this year is only the second best year in all of recorded human history, as opposed to the absolute best year. That's the good version of it. The bad version of it is that we are used to growing on a steady trend line, and we've lost about 10% of GDP relative to that trend line, and we don't seem to be gaining that back.
So the new trend line is not as good as it was in 2008.
Well, let us hope it's not a new trend line. Usually we bounce back to the old trend line. Okay. If it is a new trend line, that's not good news for us.
So what caused, should we call this a recession in 2008? Should we call it a contraction? Should we call it a depression? Or should we call it a crash? What's the best word?
Well, we had a recession.
A little multiple choice test here for our professor, John Cochran.
I like recession. Economists are increasingly calling this the Great Recession because it's the biggest one that we've seen since the
Great
Depression.
Because technically, do you buy into the NBER definition, National Bureau of Economic Research, two successive quarters of decline? Although I think it's been modified since I studied this. It sounded like it's now more of a laundry list of factors.
Well, it never was just two quarters of decline. It was,
I didn't learn that right, you mean?
A bunch of guys.
You're telling me I didn't learn it right at the University of Chicago?
It's a rough and ready rule, but in fact.
Okay. It's more than that. It's what the NBER says it is.
There's a group of wise men who get together and say, we are in recession and we are not in recession anymore. Whether that particularly means much is an open question. But loosely speaking, a recession is a time when GDP is declining and growth is a time when it's coming back. Okay.
So we had a recession. We just call it a severe recession?
Yes, we had a real jolt. A real jolt, yes.
Unemployment eventually went to, what, 10% in the United States?
Close to 10%, yes.
Okay. Which, the depression, it went over 25%.
Yes.
So let's keep it in perspective, right? This was no depression.
This is nothing like the Great Depression.
The 1930s. You have to say that because kids in school, they don't learn dates anymore because dates are not important. It's always a matter of, are you a risk taker? So we want people to go out and be risk takers like the people who ran Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, as opposed to people who can spell and know dates, right?
Well, I'm not sure.
But that's a digression. Yeah. Okay. All right.
My kids are learning lots of names and dates in school.
Because they won't go to the University of Chicago Lab School.
They do. That's
because
right.
You exercise choice.
Right.
You could send them to the public school, which would be Kenwood, but the better school in that area between those two would be the University of Chicago Lab School.
Well, I have mixed loyalties as a graduate of Kenwood High School, but...
Presumably you're a rational person. If you're sending your kids to a different school, it must be because you think you and your wife that it's better, right?
Yes.
A slight digression, folks, we're with 30 seconds. So you favor school choice for everybody. You'd like to see the people who have their kids in public schools, like the Chicago Public School, where we spend on average $15,000 per kid per year. Give them the money. And if they want to stay in the public school, they can. If not, they can take that voucher for $15,000 and go to the school of their choice. You sign up to that right now.
That certainly is the best way to provide quality education for kids, because competition is the essential discipline of our market. That's what makes things better. All the products in front of us.
Everything gets better. The private schools get better, the public schools, competition. You're about competition. If you could, you would like to bless competition everywhere in the world, whether it's an economic arena, whether it's a non-economic arena. You, the God that you worship at the University of Chicago would be competition. Am I right?
We don't worship at gods, and I don't worship at gods.
But you do think competition is a very important instrument to improving mankind's well-being.
But not for religious reasons, but because...
For material well-being.
Practical reasons, because the wealth of experience tells us that freedom of choice for people and competition among their suppliers delivers the goods.
Okay, so back again to the basics. What is it that caused this major recession?
Okay, what caused the major recession was the financial crisis, no question about
it. And what
that.
Caused the financial crisis?
What caused the financial crisis is a run in the shadow banking system.
And what caused the run on the and a shadow banking system?
All sorts of very fragile financial structures and everyone's belief that the government was in there to bail everybody out no matter what happened, which eventually came to an end.
And it's known as moral hazard. If you know the government's going to bail you out and you're a financial entity, take a lot of risk, because before you run into problems, you're going to make high rates of returns, and maybe you'll be gone before you run into problems. And if you do run into problems, you can always, Big Brother will come in and take care of you. Is that moral hazard?
That isn't. Let me come back to where you started with deposit insurance. So what we did in the 1930s is we said we don't want runs on the banks. We'll have the government stand ready for everyone's deposits. Well, that solves the run on the banks. But now the banks are gambling with the house's money. So now we need all these regulators to stop the banks from taking risks, and that's a hard game to play. And so their bailouts got bigger and bigger, and the banks took bigger and bigger risks until the whole system exploded.
And if we said no bailouts, if we had just a pronouncement, no bailouts, no more bailouts, then we would need the regulators, because individuals acting on their own, led, if you will, by an invisible hand, would take actions that the regulators might want them to take, which is don't take inordinate, unreasonable risks, because there will be nobody there to bail you out, and we'll come after you with the full vengeance of the law, and the shareholders will come after you, and you'll be a disgrace, as in, say, John Corzine, just to pick a name.
Would
you say that John Corzine is now facing disgrace because he was the CEO of, what's the name of that company?
MF Global.
And does MF stand for what we used to think about when we heard Rod Blagojevich talk about effing golden and MF and all that?
I'm sure that the people who he owes money to have many, many interesting names for
Okay, so MF Global, what did he do? He couldn't find, what is it, about $1.2 billion? No, that sounds too low. $1.2 billion, is that all? He misplaced $1.2 billion.
It was in the sock drawer yesterday.
It can happen, John. I'm sure your wife has given you static when you said, John, what'd you do with that $1.2 billion?
It was right there yesterday.
And you can't find it. Yes. So what did John Corzine do? Did he just say, we just don't know what happened? But somehow, customer accounts that reflect this $1.2 billion got transferred or commingled in with company accounts, and now they can't find it. Have I roughly represented what's happened there?
On top of taking lots of money and making a big bet on Greek bonds with it.
Okay.
I think the Corzine story is very important to remember as we now place our trust in regulators to come and stop the financial...
Because we had regulators. Sarbanes, whatever.
Yes, and we had the CFTC who was looking over MF.
And Dick Durbin just said, look, yesterday Senator Durbin said from Illinois, did they realize what they're doing? Because what, did they cut the CFTC by $100 million, right?
Go ahead.
Some amount, some large amount. And According to Durbin, that's a terrible risk to take, because if we cut the CFTC, they may do all sorts of things, like what they did before they were cut when Mr. Corzine lost $1 billion.
So we now place our great faith in the regulators under the Dodd-Frank bill to stop financial companies from getting into trouble. Okay. I think this is a good story for us to remember
it doesn't work. Well, regulation generally doesn't work. That would be the other creed coming out of the University of Chicago. You've got the research to back it up. The main creed at the University of Chicago these days is look at research, follow the research, and be an empiricist.
Yes.
Am I getting that right? It's not just to be a free market. You wouldn't say you religiously favor the free market. You would say the free market is often a better route to protecting people than regulators, if we look empirically. Did I get that right?
It's about the weight of experience.
If it went the other way, you guys would be Marxists, right? If it went the other way and regulation was good, you guys at the University of Chicago and ladies would all favor regulation, right?
Right now, it's not so simple as more or less regulation. It's about smart regulation and dumb
regulation.
I won't let you get away with that so easily, just less regulation.
So you're saying if you have smart regulation, you're on board. You think it's a good thing. You can come up with smart regulation, and you're fine with it.
There is well-crafted regulation. There's necessary regulation. Then there's stuff that doesn't work so well.
Now, Austin Goolsbee, he was there. Seriously, why did he think the $800 billion stimulus would be a good idea? He thought it would. You wouldn't. Now, you know Austin, right?
Yes, he lives across the street from me. He's on the left side of the street.
Which is appropriate, right? He went to MIT, right?
Yes, that's right.
Well-trained. He got his graduate training there, and then he came to the University of Chicago, right?
Right.
He's been at the University of Chicago now for, 15 years or so?
I don't know the number, but something like that.
Good number of years, right?
Yes.
You went to Berkeley, good institution, got your PhD there.
That's
right. You went to MIT as an undergrad, right?
That's right.
You were sort of a budding physicist and became an economist, right?
Yes, I've done lots of things in my life.
And so you've been now at the University of Chicago for, 25 years or so?
That's right.
And I'm stuck by this. Now, what's the difference? You're both smart guys. We'd like to have Austin come on the show. We'll try. Maybe you can get him on for us.
That would be fun.
Okay. He's a smart guy. You agree?
He's very smart.
Well-trained. You're a smart guy. Wait a second.
In the world, the problems of the world are not lack of smarts. Yes, that's right. Even the people who get things dramatically wrong are very smart in this world.
Okay, but the question is, you're smart, he's smart, you're well-trained, he's well-trained, probably similar training in economics, so forth, and yet he thought this would be a great idea, apparently, and you didn't. What's the difference?
I'm not working in Washington, and I don't need to come up with something for the nightly news tomorrow night to say we need a big plan.
No, but I'm just putting it aside, don't you think that Austin, even if he wasn't told this, if he was just sitting here in summer of 2008, academic discussion, and I said to Austin, do you think a stimulus program might be a good idea? Don't you think he's more likely to say yes than you, even if he's not working for the Obama administration?
So I can't speak for Austin.
There are many,
many very respectable economists who look at the evidence, look at the theory, and come out in favor of stimulus spending. And that's quite true.
And they're generally known as Keynesians, right?
Yes, the idea is Keynesian. And the basic idea, let's get it straight for people, is not just that the government should sort of keep things going in a recession, but that if I borrow money from you and then I give it to somebody else, you're worse off, they're better off, but somehow this act, if I borrow $1 for you and give it to Joe, that we all get $1.50 better off. That's the magic of stimulus, which I think doesn't work.
But more than that, it's a deficit. The government is spending more than it takes in taxes, but you're saying it makes up for that deficit by selling bonds, which you call borrowing from somebody else. But that deficit is thought to infuse the economy with stimulus, right?
That's right.
Some people say it's not just the deficit, it's actually the infusion of government spending. So even if you didn't have a deficit, even if you raised taxes, we used to have this thing called a balanced budget multiplier of one. So if you raise government spending by $800 billion, you raise taxes by $800 billion, you could do the math, according to the Keynesians, you would have a stimulus, right?
That's the second.
Not as much as if you didn't raise taxes.
That's right.
But still, you'd have a stimulus.
But you have to.
Keynesians believe that, right?
You have to admire the magic.
They do worship on that. I mean, they go to church every Sunday and they say, "Oh, I worship under the Keynesians." And the conservatives over there worship under Milton Friedman on monetarism. I'm saying that's how it used to be, but no more.
Right. It's not
it's
about
a little
worship.
It's more subtle.
It's about understanding the facts, understanding the theory. And your tax-supported idea is the idea that if I take a dollar from you in taxes that you were going to spend on something, and I, the government, spend it on something else, somehow we all get a dollar and a half.
Because don't
off.
You understand, I wasn't going to spend it. It was an idle cash balance. Okay, I mean, I think if I have some money here, I always, when you go, it's easy you lose $1 billion, you know. But, okay, so here, I actually got some cash. So I remember when I was studying economics at the University of Chicago, the wise guys over there, like Milton Friedman, would say, okay, you have some young kid coming in, he's a Keynesian, first year graduate school, you thought stimulus were a good idea. He says, because some of these cash balances, I'm not going to spend, Mr. Friedman, they're idle. And so Milton would say, show me which dollar is idle. Is it this dollar? Is it this dollar? You know? So the point is they're not idle. They're there in my pocket. Maybe I'm not spending it now, but I know I could spend it, and I might spend it. They're not idle. Well, did Milton get it right?
Let me update what you're saying.
Okay.
What we don't want to confuse is a tax and spending issue and a money issue. If the problem is money, not enough money or too much money, we have a Federal Reserve that can handle it. When we're talking about fiscal stimulus, we're talking about let the Fed get the money stuff right, and then on top of that, borrowing from you, so you won't buy a mortgage or buy a new house. Borrowing that money from you, giving it to someone else, makes us all a dollar and a half better off.
The Keynesians believe that. You don't.
That's exactly right.
Okay. And we're running out of time. It goes all too fast. We're going to continue to speak as the credits roll.
Okay.
But
well,
I very
pleasure.
Much want to thank our guest, Professor John Cochran from the University of Chicago, Booth School of Business. It's known as the Booth School of Business because, what was the guy's name?
David Booth.
He gave $300 million, what was it, a few years ago, four or five years ago. And so what used to be known as the Graduate School of Business
is now the Booth School of Business.
Okay.
That's right.
And so
and we're thankful
for
Mr.
the marketing
Booth.
People at the University of Chicago, the name of that is, again?
Booth School of Business.
Okay. And if you want to get a quality education, you should go over to Hyde Park or downtown. Do you still have the downtown center?
We have Hyde Park, we have downtown,
the Bleacher
we have
center.
Around the world. We are the best place for management education in the world.
And you will understand things better than the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors, Austin Goolsbee.
Well, or at least as well as, because
at least as well, because he teaches at the University of Chicago. He's back teaching right there.
But you will hear both sides of the debate and extremely well presented.
And that's what the University of Chicago is about.
That is what we are about.
It's the life of the mind, not just the college, but the graduate school. It is the glorification of the life of the mind.
That's right. Now, how did this turn into a University of Chicago marketing device?
Well, I don't know. I think could we get Austin Goolsbee here? I mean, he's got to be heard from. We've used his name. We have to give him a fair chance. Austin, could you come over here and explain how we either got it wrong or you could get it right? But so looking forward, 2012, what do you predict for the growth in GDP?
So I don't do predictions.
No, don't go quality. Just give me a number.
Sorry.
2%, 3%, 4%?
I have no idea.
You're almost certain it'll be positive, right?
My prediction is for slow growth, which is actually a disaster.
Slow means 2 to 3%?
Something in there. China trundling along while we wait for Europe to blow up.
The stock market, it's Dow Jones is almost 12,000. Come one year, what will the Dow Jones be?
Now, come on. My
father-in-law
invented efficient markets. I don't predict the stock market.
So the joke is you have two economists walking down the street, the Chicago economist, the non-Chicago economist. There's a $50 bill in front of them. And the non-Chicago economist notices that the Chicago economist is not going to pick up the $50 bill. And he says, aren't you going to pick up the $50 bill? And the Chicago economist says, what?
It can't be there, because if it were there, the market would have picked it up already.
Somebody would have picked it up. And that's the definition of an efficient market. And
no,
you believe in the
right.
efficient market, right?
No, an efficient market is a market where...